Hello, welcome to the UGC EPG Pathshala program in linguistics. I am Professor Anvita Abbi. Now we begin our week 6, and in this week we are going to consider two modules, module number 9 and module number 10. These are the two modules which are the real hardcore modules, because we are now reaching also towards the end of the course, which these modules will train you how to prepare a multilingual interactive dictionary, multilingual and multiscriptal also, an interactive dictionary. So interactive means with the sound files you will be able to produce this dictionary, and we will also teach you how to write a grammatical sketch. Now these are the two main objectives of any linguist working on a new language, that one should have a good dictionary and a good descriptive grammar of the language. So the tools must be good and appropriate, and as well as the analysis must be very clear. So for this we have to train you first to how to elicit the proper elements for preparing the dictionary, and how to transcribe and translate each and every word. So module 9 will be concerned with semantic fields and preparation of multilingual dictionary, and module 10 will be devoted to how to write a brief grammatical sketch. Let me warn you that these are the very long materials that can be consulted by reading several books, and in this module we will try to be as brief as possible. Basically, the modules are to guide you how to approach writing a grammatical sketch and how to preparing a dictionary. We have given some screenshots of some unwritten languages or the dying languages, grammar and dictionary, so that you know how your dictionary should look like. To begin with, we will now concentrate on semantic fields and preparation of multilingual dictionary. Module 9. We are concerned in this module to prepare a multilingual, multiscriptal and interactive dictionary, and to produce that I will recap some of the issues that we did discuss in the last modules, but it is very important to refresh and to add one or two more new points. One is that when you're preparing a dictionary and collecting words, don't be influenced by folk beliefs. Because the folk belief might say, this is not a language, this is a dialect, this is not a word in this particular language, don't collect it. Don't go by such kind of notions. You collect whatever words the consultant is giving you, whether it is of dialect or language, because if he's speaking that language, it is a language for us. And we don't get into the nomenclature of dialect and language. Secondly, what I emphasized in the earlier modules, be theory independent, so follow the BLT. Sharpen your ears so that you don't miss any variations. Variations are very important. Don't think that variations are not good for nothing. Not only sometimes free variations are important, sometimes they indicate that the person has been changing his language because the language is dying. So sharpen your ears. Take a representative sample of all age, class, caste and gender groups, and choose an appropriate eliciting techniques or a combination of couple of techniques. Sometimes you have to use the pictorial method and direct method at the same time. Make an appropriate questionnaire to begin with. Sometimes some linguists say they don't start with questionnaire, but we advocate that you start with questionnaire, so you are focused, the consultant is focused, and you achieve and arrive at some point at the end of the day. Do not use linguistic jargons in the field, and don't say, oh, this is not a noun, or how would you give an adjective, and how do you give nouns and verbs. Don't use linguistic jargon in the field, because your consultant will be very annoyed, and the foremost is that you should be humble and polite. The second aspect is that when you begin eliciting data for dictionary, first thing, and this is for the syntax and the grammar writing also, first make a template for eliciting information about the informant. And this is given on your slide, one of the slides, and you can look at it. the name of the consultant, the primary language that he speaks, what is the mother's tongue, what are the other languages, is he multilingual, so what are the other languages that he speaks, read and write, his age, gender, education, etc., etc. So if the language is migrant to that locality, you must ask, why did he migrate and when did he migrate, or when did he migrate? So those are the two important issues. Now let me give you some hardcore and very useful tips about audio recording. We generally make a mistake in doing this. First is, audio format must be the WAV file, and avoid using MP3 format. And mode of recording, channel should be stereo with a sampling rate of 44,000 hertz, a bit rate of 16 bit. You can read about the details about this in your handout, the module number 9 that has been the write-up that is given to you. When you are using a recorder, please disable the automatic input gain mode, because this is not going to help you, and the input volume may be increased only when required, because normal is 70%. To obtain clear recording, hold the microphone at the side of the mouth and not in front of the mouth, okay? And it is recommended that you wear the earphones while recording to ensure the quality of the recording. In every recording that you make, please make a statement first, the name of the language, the consultant name, the location, date and time, and the category. That is it a basic word list? Is it a basic sentence list? Or is it a semantic fields? So all these, the category that you are using, or the kind of questionnaire that you are using, has to be specified before the consultant begins his recording. You should speak in your own voice what it is. Other aspect is that while the consultant is speaking, you don't speak in the middle, and complete the words to avoid any kind of audio overlapping. All audio files should be segmented and sliced using Audacity or any other software that you are aware of, which helps you editing the audio files. But before uploading the files on the computer, one has to rename them for easy accessibility. For example, you can write the name of the word that you have elicited, because now we are talking about dictionaries, so you can name the word, but or the semantic field, depending upon how you are trying to group or collate the data. So you can, but you have to rename them. But while renaming, be careful you don't delete the WAV, .WAV, the marker on it. Or if you are uploading the pictures, don't remove the .JPG marking on it, because all pictures must be in the JPEG format with high resolution. I would recommend you try to avoid the mobile phones for taking pictures, because we are talking about the interactive dictionary with pictures and audio files. It is necessary that you take your pictures in a very high resolution. And video files, if you want to insert in your dictionary, has to be annotated using eLine software. When you take a video or audio, preferably, you must try to use tripod. For recording that what I just suggested above should be followed. After the recording and after the elicitation of the data of words and the exemplary sentences, you must have exemplary sentences for each word that you're going to put in the dictionary. The next very important issue is to make a file of metadata. Metadata is a file about the data. That is what is recorded where and what it conveys, how long or duration of it is in the audio file or the video file, who are the main key players of this particular audio, the video files, you know. And so this information has to be recorded, when the data was elicited, the location of the data, all this is very important, because ultimately when you will have thousands and thousands of words and you're trying to locate one particular word, then one particular audio recording or video recording, then it will be very handy to immediately hunt for the right and appropriate word. The sample copy of the metadata with one entry is already provided to you on the PowerPoint, and you can have a look at it. But keep in mind that every data or every information that you put in the metadata has to be numbered in a sequence. So the, without numbering, it has no meaning. So numbering has to be put, you need to be very careful. The other question that is generally concerns us while making a dictionary is which orthography should be followed. Well, the linguistic data should be given in the IPA, International Phonetic Alphabet, and this is easily downloadable from the SIL website. And in the beginning, you will be eliciting data in narrow transcription because you do not know what are the allophones and the phonemes. But as you move on, you have to record the data in broad transcription. But it should be IPA and nothing else. If the language is written, one, try to learn the indigenous orthography so that you can put along with the IPA, the indigenous orthography symbols along in the dictionary. If the orthography is not ever been used for this language, that means this language was never written down, this is the time you can perhaps as a linguist give an orthography, give a script to this language, and that will be a very good social service that you can do after doing the phonemic analysis, which I'm going to talk about how to do the phonemic analysis. You can identify the phonemes of the language, and depending upon what is the state language of that state where this community reside, you can perhaps adopt that state language or any other script that is familiar to the community members or to you, which has as many symbols as possible to depict the sound system of that language, can be followed to give a script. In fact, I realized that Devanagari seems to be one of the most scientific and one of the best script available with us, which can fit more or less to large number of languages requirements. So you can try the Devanagari script also, but try to make it multi-scriptal dictionary which can be used widely by general people. Now coming to the phonological analysis, you start with the basic word list that we talked about, BWL, and after eliciting 30 words, start making a phonetic chart of the sounds that you've elicited. So you have a phonetic chart filling in all the vowels, all the consonants, all the diphthongs. If you found tones, then write the tones also. So this will be a very, very preliminary phonetic chart after eliciting 30 words. After 30 words, you can also start seeing what are the grammatical categories that you have arrived at. There are nouns, there are verbs, there are adjectives, and maybe somehow you've already found out that the distinction between noun and verb don't exist. And while eliciting the data on noun, the consultant may have said, well, we can use it this way and we can also use it that way. That means the same word can be used as a referent category or the action category. You can also start separating words for body parts. So you collect some more data, let's say 100 words. After 100 words, you can start segregating words which are referring to the body parts. Do you see anything unusual in collecting the body parts? Maybe the word for body or word for human or a pronoun preceding the term. So be careful and keep your ears open, because the body part terms do not generally come in isolation. They're either preceded by a pronoun or by a human term for human or by the term for body division or by the term for body. Similarly, kinship terms, you may also collect words, and do you find something funny while collecting kinship term, because they are also preceded by some kind of a referent noun, whose father or whose mother the person is. Do you also get homonyms? Try to identify, look for homonyms in your data, and also try to look for polysemous words. Homonyms and polysemous words you should write separately. So by the time you arrive, by the time you collect 250 words, the basic word list, you would be able to get all these aspects that I just talked about, polysemic words, homophonous words, body part, kinship terms, and so on and so forth. And you see, try to see that how they are different from the rest of the words. Do they have any kind of prefixing element or suffixing element obligatorily attached to them? Now then, what you can do is that after this collection of 250 words, You can also look for the phonology, you can also look for the phonemes in the language. Now, your phonetic chart should be filled in every day. More and more new sounds you find, keep on filling in the phonetic chart. And once you have a full chart completed, you can do two things. First thing is, you can also do phonemic analysis, and the second thing is, you start putting various, go to the word list and start putting the words together to make small phrases. But let us first talk about the phonological analysis, of which you can start doing after 100 words, in fact. And after 100 words, you can also start making a separate list for some kind of problematic sounds, which you may like to run some kind of acoustic study by running Pratt or Audacity. So note down the problematic sounds separately and the non-problematic sounds separately. The problematic sounds are those in which you'll find lot of variations, or those which a person pronounces and you are unable to hear it carefully. You are not able to hear very carefully, I should say. The other thing is that you can, after 250 words, or actually even earlier than that, even when you have collected 100 words, start making small phrases, because you already have nouns, you have already have adjectives and verbs in your list and other categories, so you can start putting the words together to make small phrases. So you can put a noun and adjective together and ask the informant, can you say this? In fact, this process is very, very welcoming by the consultant, because he thinks that you've already learned the language and now you're speaking it, because you're collecting, you're collocating two words and making small phrases. So start putting noun with adjectives and adverb with noun, and you can also see whether the verb comes before the noun and after the noun to check the word order. You can also sometimes at this stage segregate the last syllable of the verb to check whether it is an imperative form or it is the infinitive form. For example, if you ask the verb, start collecting the words for verbs in Hindi, generally people say say the verb with the ana suffix, so khana, jana, peena, won. But the ana is an infinitive suffix which is added to the root morpheme, like kha, ja, so. So you can, if you find recurrent occurrence of morphemes in the verbal morphology, you can easily segregate that as either infinitive or imperative, because many consultants, instead of giving infinitives, give you imperative construction like they, kha, pi, so. Sometimes the imperative forms tally or are the same homophonous with the root form, sometimes they are not. But this is the time that you can separate these and find out what is the root morphemes. You can also note down any other grammatical information that has come across while eliciting the data. Coming back to the phenomena of establishing phonemes, you see the grammar writing or the dictionary writing, there are many actions which are done simultaneously or coterminously, because one cannot segregate one from the other. You have to make small phrases also to elicit the information on phonemic analysis. You also have to, don't think that you just have to collect words to do phonemic analysis. Many times morphophonemic changes tells you a lot when you employ the word or employ words into small phrases. So when you want to establish phonemes, first thing first, you make look for suspicious pair of sounds. For example, pa, ba, ta, da, ka, ga, make suspicious pair of sounds. I'm sure you remember your course on phonology. So the phonetically similar sounds should be grouped together, and try to find the, after the second step is to try to find them into contrastive environment. If they occur in contrastive environment, certainly they are two different phonemes. If they don't occur in contrastive environments, they perhaps are allophones of the same one phoneme, or maybe there are in free variation. So you have to rule out this possibility or establish this possibility with confidence. For this, It's best is to collect minimal pairs. Minimal pairs is when the two sounds distinguish, there are two different words only distinguished by one particular sound, distinguished by one particular feature, so like spala and bala. And so try to find out minimal pairs and see whether the sounds occur in contrastive environment. If you don't find two sounds in minimal pairs, make it try to look for subminimal pairs. That is when they, when the two sounds under consideration are distinguished from each other by two features, not one feature. However, if you don't find any particular pairs within the language, you can make nonsensical words just to establish the identity of the phoneme. So you can retake a word which you already have and rhyme it with a nonsensical word and ask the consultant, can you say this? And if you can say this, what does it mean? Maybe sometimes you do come across a real word, and if you don't, then the person may say, no, this is not the word we will use, or we do not know what this word is. But you may be able to identify the phoneme of the language which is there in the real word. Whenever you find there are two words which subminimal pair, then try to identify the environment, the phonetic environment or morphological environment or any other situation responsible for the variation. So this is very important to establish the allophones. So once you establish the allophones, now then you would know how many sounds exist for one particular phoneme, and it will help you giving the script ultimately to that language. And you should also isolate those words which are in free variation. Now, when you make two words and three words phrases, after identifying phonemes, allophones and free variation, you make these two word phrases from the collected data. Don't ask the consultant to give you new data, because you already have by now 300 basic word list words, or you may have the Indian basic word list stock with you. So you can easily make the small word two word phrases, two words phrases, and move on to the three word phrases. This will give you following things. One, it will give you the word order, what the language is. It will also give you the ordering of the modifier and the modified. It will also give you the situation of affixes, whether the language has prefixes or suffixes or infixes. It will also give you the information on inflection and derivation. It will also give you, if it's a tonal language, it will also give you information on tonal differences when words are conjoined, because sometimes the tones change when the words are conjoined. So when you will be using two words, three words in a phrase, maybe the tones change. And it will also give you collocational restrictions. Sometimes, you know, you can find out that this is not used with this. For example, if you're, except let's say you're collecting words with in Hindi, and you collocate bada with aag, so one adjective, one noun, then the informant or the consultant may correct you. No, you cannot say bada aag, you have to say badi aag. So you know there is an agreement phenomena in this language, and aag is considered to be feminine, not masculine. So immediately you get some information on the gender, and you get some information on the agreement. Hence, making two word phrases or three word phrases gives you a lot of syntactic information as well as a lot of morphological information. Similarly, the variation aspect, if there is a variation, that will also be very much depicted in the two word and three word phrases. But above all, the two word phrases and three word phrases give you the various word formation processes of derivation. Inflecting example I just gave you about the gender agreement, but derivation also, and compounding, because you should also compound two nouns, two adjectives, two adverbs to see whether this can exist or not. Basically, you are trying out within the limited stock of data that you have elicited from the consultant and seeing what kind of word formation processes exist. You can start employing the words in a reduplicated fashion. So you can employ, as you know, we have seen in module 6 that reduplication is a aerial feature. So you can start duplicating a noun, start duplicating adjectives, and confirm from the consultant whether this is allowed or not allowed. And when it is not allowed, write it as an area to be probed into further. So derivation, compounding, reduplication, inflection, and any other, for example, though it, you have not collected out of 300 words, but you can you can use expressive morphology of making a fictitious morphology and make the consultant correct you. See, after this preliminary work of 300 basic word list of the Indian context and making two word phrases and three word phrases, you start collecting words and phrases depending upon some kind of semantic fields and grammatical fields. When you are making a dictionary, you must keep in mind that depending upon the location in the community that you're investigating, your semantic fields can either enlarge or diminish. But you have to think of the as many semantic fields as you can think of while making dictionary, because this will enrich your dictionary. I remember we had to identify 42 semantic fields when we were making an interactive dictionary of Greek and mnemonics. Some of the fields are given on the slides here. For example, kinship terms, address terms, pronouns of all kinds, professional names. When you take professional names, you must check whether there is a name specially for female professions, household items, seasons, weather, time, celestial bodies. Because everybody has names and these are unchanged, you know, celestial bodies and whatever you see in the sky. Various kinds of the names for pain, illnesses, disease, and body parts. Now, body parts can be, and always collect body parts, as I suggested earlier, by this, somebody's this, somebody's that, kind of my nose, his ears, like that. Numeral and other ways of enumeration or measurement. The societies which are not educated also have ways of measuring the commodities, even when they have barter system. So you can always collect those terms. The terms for adornment, costumes, dresses, the way women adorn themselves, flora and fauna, edible items, and games, toys, sports, cooking terms. And when I say cooking terms, there's a plethora of information that you can collect on this. Now, in the write-up of the module, this in number 9, we have already given a big long list of this. Which kind of semantic fields you can study. But I'm also giving in the PowerPoint presentation how you can download the toolbox from the SILVEL website, which is a very useful tool to do the to make the dictionary. And this is the toolbox program can be. The toolbox program available with the SIL website, SIL, Summer School in Linguistics, is the program that most of the linguists use to record their data, to store their data, and also it is very convenient to have give interlinear gloss. And there's another, and the data stored in toolbox can be easily transported or exportable to LexicPro program, which is a very friendly program to show a dictionary which is interactive. I have given the website's addresses here, and you can look at those to see how to recommend how to get these. Now, but you must, for details, you consult module 9, and I have given some screenshots on your from toolbox on your website, on your PowerPoint slides, so that you can see that how various fields in linguistic dictionary are recorded, noted, and transcribed here, so that it gives the good dictionary, printable dictionary at the end. So you can see the toolbox program. It gives you the facility of seeing the multiple entries at the same time and the multiple categories of the multiple entries at the same time. So for this, as you can see, the data has to be elicited in such a way that all kinds of information of local objects are recorded. And if you find some interesting observation or interesting indigenous information, you should write it under NT notes. And these also come very handy to understand the phenomena of new objects or new activity. We also advocate using LexicPro, and as I said, toolbox program can be exported in LexicPro because it has a fantastic search engine and a multilingual search engine, and not only for a particular word, but also the kind of switching it can make easily between different languages and different grammatical categories and different semantic fields is very useful for us. The entry in the Lexic Pro is also given on the website on the of this PowerPoint, and you can see that on the left hand side on the margin there is all kinds of words are given, and it shows that which has the sound files. You can click on that and that can be shown to you. So this can be downloaded from the SIL field as SIL website, which is easily available. Semantic fields as discussed above can be very elaborate and inclusive, as can be seen by the extreme left column under the categories in the previous slide. So, or in the following slide also, because I'm showing you the following slide, which is again from the Lexic Pro, and you can see all these categories means the semantic fields. There are all kinds of categories that can be listed on the left hand side, and the moment you click on any of them, the page goes on to that page. That's how Lexic Pro is advocated for multilingual dictionary. So multilingual dictionary can be achieved or arrived at only if you elicit the data very, very extensively. Don't think that any information is irrelevant. Any object, any activity that you get your data from, try to store that data under NT or explanations, because the Lexic Pro and Toolbox program gives you enough opportunity to record all kinds of indigenous knowledge that you acquire in the field. To conclude, in this module, we saw that how the information about the consultant should be recorded. We also suggested appropriate measures to adopt a suitable orthography or orthographies, and we discussed in detail how one has to move on from one word elicitation for phonemic analysis to the two word and three word elicitation to corroborate for phonemic analysis, as well as to arrive at morphological information. And various semantic fields have been suggested under which data can be elicited. This is because to make your dictionary very rich. So in a way, this module should have helped you to create the interactive dictionary, which can be ultimately have audio files, video files, different orthography and meanings, extensive meanings to justify the language that you are investigating.